I have the luxury here of teaching to my passion. And I love it here, and I teach here because I teach what I believe. Science is science. When we talk about the combustion of fossil fuels, there's no arguing that when you burn a hydrocarbon, you release carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. That is not debatable. That's science. But one thing I love about environmental science is I teach the science, and then there's all sorts of opportunity to discuss and debate and reflect on what the implications of science are, which I think is really interesting.
How do we really leverage all that we've built, both the infrastructure of an educational institution like that, but also our knowledge and our talents and our aspirations between the public sector and the private sector, and advance it exponentially? Because I think we can. I think what's in our way is not, it's significant, but it's not insurmountable. And part of the breakthrough of our program is really bringing together these two cultures, public and private sector, and their different ways of doing things and different ways of spending money, and trying to synergize the innovation part. And I think what comes out of that, looking ahead, how do we live truly sustainably, is going to be a set of questions we haven't even formulated yet.
I think it's absolutely critical that in any educational institution, be it kindergarten all the way up to, you know, PhD, I think you have to have an education on conservation, on using energy efficiently. Everything we do from, you know, beyond breathing is using energy. And pretty much all of it is oil. Some of it's coal, but we're talking about using energy in a way that is just unbelievable. If you went 100 years back, the amount of energy we're using today is staggering. And because that energy is there and it is, quote, cheap, we squander it. And we use it to do all kinds of things we should be doing in a different way. And I think an education is necessary to make people realize how precious the energy that we have is.
We actually have now sort of four programs that deal with environmental issues. We have the Environmental Studies Natural Resources program. We have the Peace, Social Justice, and Environmental Studies program. And we have the Renewable Energy Efficiency program. Then there's the newest program, the Farm and Food Systems program. All of these are under the liberal arts program, and all are degrees in liberal arts with a program focus on those things. And there's actually considerable differences between them. The renewable energy and energy efficiency program, more so than the others, is very practical. The requirements and the electives are much more in the hands-on nature of renewable energy and energy efficiency.
2007 is when we really started it in earnest, and it went from the 1 4-credit course to 24 courses in the course of over 3 years, with an infusion of workforce development money. And that was, it sounds like, you know, money is money, but workforce development money actually did shape a lot of how we thought about and collaborated on the program. So, you know, we're an academic program, and that has certain philosophies and approaches and assessments and that sort of thing, and also a certain audience that it would. Workforce development has a whole other philosophy and approach and audience. And we really brought those together in a way that astonished me and really has been a lot of fun as a teacher. Like, oh, they have very tangible, specific skills people need in the workplace and broader, deeper knowledge they need in life and also to continue to advance their learning forever that we've always been wrestling with in the department. And you bring those together and you have something really pretty extraordinary that attracts a dynamic mix of folks, and that in of itself, in a classroom, in a program, creates a whole learning environment that is extraordinary.
I like to do hands-on, so we try to make sure that the courses that we're giving are giving students the ability to really get into it, get into the materials, get into handling it, getting to feel, touch, take apart, put back together. This is a way that you can really understand what's happening. I use a lot of PowerPoints because I like visual, lots of imagery, lots of designs, diagrams. These are the things that you have to know and understand in order to really be able to work with systems of the varying types. But we're now being able to get out into the field and do work with actual equipment.
What spawned this renewable energy efficiency program was partly driven by our own personal ethics and our own personal philosophies and our own personal desires to be the leaders and be on the forefront of educational efforts to promote renewable energy and energy efficiency. So this was driven by our passion to do what we thought was the right thing.
The program that we were creating in collaboration with all our business and other partners in 2007 and 2008 is looking very different in 2011 and 2012 and into the future. So it's always a conversation and back and forth with the world out there. And that both makes it a little daunting and very exciting. And every group of people who comes in changes it because of who they are and where their vision is and where they want to move with this. So it's very dynamic. So we've created it, but it is so far from done.
Anybody who says they don't learn something new every day is kidding themselves, because we're always learning, and then I incorporate everything I learned into my courses, and anything that's new I will incorporate as well. Again, it means changing, and that's just one thing I find, that you get a course developed, and that's great for that one semester. And then you got to go back and you got to go through it again, especially in our field here, because the technologies are changing so rapidly. So I go back and I review through all my PowerPoints, update them, new information, get new equipment, and away we go.
We had this marvelous opportunity, essentially, to invent the wheel. We went out and did a search, what other programs are out there. It's like, there aren't any. UMass didn't have one. The four-year institutions were well behind us, and programs or institutions had certain classes, and they had building classes, and they had green building classes. But with very few exceptions, there were not programs that were out there. So it was a wonderful personal and professional opportunity for us to forge into what was new territory.
The program itself, I was really the facilitator, because there were dozens and dozens of employers and other educators and nonprofit folks and community-based folks who gave us a lot of input on what the program should be, both nitty-gritty, this specific thing and this specific course, but also overall, structurally, how do you have access for many, many different pathways in?
It's great, because I know an awful lot about this stuff, but I'm always learning, because I'm always learning from my students. We have a wide range of students, from people who are just looking for a new career to get into, so their understanding is basic and they want to learn a lot more, to people who are actually in the field and just want to get a different idea, some different ways of looking at some of the technologies. So it's always a great time to have discussions, and you'll have the people who are out there working in the field will say, well, no, I do it this way, and I'm there, hey, great, another way to do it. I don't know everything. And so it's wonderful to have some of these professional people coming in and sharing their expertise.
The academic, the vocational, what I come to think of as the relevance and the reverence of what learning is all about. And what I've discovered is that we're not a technical college, so we're always up against constraints. If we don't have shops, we don't have big pieces of equipment. Whenever I go to visit the technical high schools, I just drool over their facilities. So we've partnered with those high schools so we can offer some of those facilities. Our approach is academic, because that's who we are. That's where we teach from. Continually interfacing with the people in the field. In fact, a lot of our instructors are practitioners by day and instructors by night, and so they inherently bring with them those skills. But the balance piece is an ongoing, attention's too strong a word, but dynamic, right? Back and forth. And skills are embedded in knowledge, right? They're not really separable. And we think of sort of skills applied as vocational and knowledge theory as academic, but to decouple them is really not genuine. So we're really being transparent about these are embedded in one another. When people have certain skills, they can access knowledge in a whole different way.
It is a program driven by change. We're constantly tweaking, we're constantly pulling, we're constantly adding. We offer classes we think have tremendous potential. So it's certainly a work in progress and always will be, but that's quite exciting. I like works in progress because there's always growth and change and professional development there for me personally and for our students to have input into, and the community have input into how to make those changes.
I think we'll see increasingly people want to reconnect with living systems because it's very sort of elemental, right, to who we are as human beings. And I see that as an interesting counterpoint to all this very high, more technologically oriented green stuff. Green tech is very important and fascinating. It's the electric vehicle, it's the retrofit, and yet it is all technical, and we're also biological, right? We are living, breathing biological beings and have this intense attraction to nature, I think. So holding both those things is really important to the whole of sustainability. And I think we're really aspiring to do that here. Even though we recognize one person might be really drawn to the technical, and one person might be really drawn to the woods or the farm, they both, all those pieces belong.